Good evening and welcome. We're enjoying the snow this week. Been out playing with my snowblower. Hopefully all of you guys have been having fun too in the snow. But we're on our Lenten journey, this 40-day journey to the cross and Calvary, the horrors of Good Friday, but the joy of Easter morning. And something to look forward to. And as we make this journey, there's this Lenten season, I've got a plan where I go through the six chief parts in the catechism over a 3-year period during Advent and Lent. I started doing this back years ago when I had a triple parish, and that was a lot of fun. And we had a good turnout for the services and this review of something that's very near and dear to us. You know, many of us study the catechism when we're kids and often don't pick it back up when we're adults. And so I thought we were going to combine the confirmation class with the service. Good review for mom and dad and grandma and grandpa also. So there's small catechisms on the back table, and they're a simple explanation of Christianity. They're from CPH. It's just the small catechism, but it says a simple explanation of Christianity on the front cover. And you can grab one on your way home. It's a good review. Martin Luther said that even as a doctor of theology, he would study the Ten Commandments, the Apostles' Creed, the Lord's Prayer, all of his life. And you get something new out of it every time you read them, recite them. And it's such a simple, succinct explanation of Christianity. And we as Lutheran Christians, I don't think we really appreciate that. You know, it's 27 pages. It's really thin. Luther's small catechism, as head of the household should teach it in a simple way to his family. And so that's what we're doing as we go. We're going through the first five commandments this Lenten season and during the 5 weeks between Ash Wednesday and Holy Week. And so thank you for joining me on this journey, and pick a catechism up on the way out and read a portion of that during your personal devotions each day. And we're gonna begin by standing and singing our opening song. This is the day which the Lord has made.
let us rejoice and be glad in it. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and repents of evil. Jesus said, if any man would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Christ was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Reading from 2 Chronicles, the 6th chapter. But will God indeed dwell with man on the earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built? Yet have regard to the prayer of your servant and to his plea, O Lord my God, listening to the cry and to the prayer that your servant prays before you, that your eyes may be open day and night towards this house, the place where you have promised to set your name, that you may listen to the prayer that your servant offers towards this place, and listen to the pleas of your servant and your people, Israel, when they pray towards this place, and listen from heaven, your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And a reading from Acts, the 4th chapter. On the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes gathered together in Jerusalem with Ananias the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and all who were of the high priestly family. And when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, by what power or by what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we're being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is a stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone, and there is salvation and no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from Matthew, the 6th chapter. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And we rise and we recite together the Ten Commandments. You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. And we confess the creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This time I invite the children to come forward for the children.
Well, good evening. You guys should scoot up just a little bit. I don't bite very hard. And but I you know what? I get to go over to Open Arms and I have the children's message from Sunday 10 times over there during the week. And in each classroom I get to around and see all those kids, and it's a lot of fun. And most of them don't go to, I mean, I don't know of any of them that come to church here. But they all know when I get there, I ask them, what am I going to be talking about? And they say, Jesus. And but tonight, I have this name tag, and that's what made me think of that. I have this name tag, and on there's a code thing to get through the door. But what does that name tag say? Yeah, Pastor Andy. No, what does pastor mean? What? Preacher?
Called and ordained servant of God.
Well, it actually comes from the word for, like, pasture. Have you ever heard of a pasture? That's where sheep feed, right? On grass? And that's a derivative of that. But it does mean somebody who preaches, somebody who's called by God to lead the congregation. But it's a shepherd. That's what pastor means, shepherd. And then you know what Andy means?
You.
Strong.
It comes from the Greek word andros, meaning man or manly. And then there's Carlson, and that's a family name. You know what that means? Son of Carl. And the Swedes are simple folk. And it was the commoners were just named after their dad. Well, he's the son of Carl, or he's the son of John, or that's where you get the word Johnson, Peterson, Carlson. And by the way, Carl was a Swedish name meaning manly also. So I like to say it's manly man, but a shepherd, right? And each of our names, you can ask your mom and dad about what your name means. And there's meanings to names, and it's fun to find out. And about our family names, where they come from. Yeah.
What is my name?
We'll talk about that. I don't know, Judy, and I'm just Judith, and I'll look that up. We'll figure that out. Yeah, but looking up, sometimes we look up our names and find them out, and it's interesting. And there's also there's the sacred name for God. There's a special name. There's God is a generic term. What is it?
Emmanuel.
No.
Jesus.
It's Yahweh is the name for God. Moses asked God from the burning bush. Now who should? And Pharaoh asked, says who? Who should I say? He said, tell them I am sent you. And I am the one who is, in Hebrew, is Yahweh. And it means just simply the one who is. But we call him God, right? And that's another term.
But there's God the Father. And then there's the
Son, God the Son. And what does Jesus' name mean? You know what? Well, yeah, there's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but what does Jesus' name mean?
Emmanuel.
That means, Emmanuel means God with us, and that was one of the names for Jesus, but Jesus, it means in Hebrew, it means one who saves. Would you say Savior?
Our Savior.
Our Savior. And Jesus means one who saves, or Savior, right. And that's what his name meant. And there's the Holy Spirit, and it's like God's spirit that rests on us. As Christians, we have the Holy Spirit on us. Isn't that amazing? When we're baptized, we're baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, right? We're all three names. They're three, yet one. Three persons, yet one. That's one of those mystery things that we don't understand, we believe. And the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, he places his name on us. And one of those names it means Savior, right? One who saves, we're saved by him. He washes our sins away and places his name on us. And we have a special family name as Christians, because all of us are brothers and sisters, right? In Christ, we're brothers and sisters in Christ. And we have a special family name, and what is that?
Christ.
That's where, you know, it's Christ, yeah, Christian, and of Christ, it means. And we have that special family name given to us in our baptisms. We'll pray. You want to pray with me? We'll pray. Thank you. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
For putting your name on me.
When I was baptized.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, thank you for coming up.
Thank you. Second commandment.
You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so that we do not curse, swear, use satanic arts, lie or deceive by his name, but call upon it in every trouble, pray, praise, and give thanks. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We hear again from Exodus chapter 20, the second commandment. You should not misuse the name of the Lord your God. You know, I spent 5 years on active duty with sailors and Marines. They have a rather unique vocabulary, like affirmative instead of yes, and negative instead of no, and another expansive vocabulary that's not repeatable in church. And in all those years, I didn't pick up on their lingo. I just never had a knack for, well, using colorful language. But I remember in the Navy, we had Navy OSHA requirements. We had to have earplugs on our hanging on our belt. And so when we were in a noisy area on the ship, we would take those out and put them in so to protect our hearing. Well, when I was talking to sailors and Marines and they were waxing eloquent, I'd just start taking those earplugs out and I'd start putting them in. Chaplain, what are you doing? I said, I'm putting in my sailor or Marine vocabulary inhibitors. It's okay, Chaplain. I'll clean up my language. Well, you know what I'm talking about if you work construction or, well, maybe from yourself when you stub your toe or smash your thumb. It might be just a little too easy to let loose with some curse words or vulgarities. And it's so easy for some, and God says, hey, my name is sacred. It's special. It's not just an expression. You know, I've sworn several times in my life, and before judges, I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help me God. I swore before a Navy officer when I swore in as an officer in the Navy. I swear to uphold the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. That's the kind of swearing we're supposed to do, not the other stuff. But here, you know, the Ten Commandments, one old confirmation teaching tool is the Ten Commandments work as a curb. In other words, keeps order in society, like do not murder, etc. There's the mirror of God's law that's held up before our face and we see ourselves as we really are, not as we like to pretend ourselves to be or think of ourselves as being good people. And there's also the guide, the law as guide. It shows us the direction that we're called to go as disciples. In the Great Commission, Jesus says, to go and teach them everything I've commanded you. Baptize them and teach them everything I've commanded you. That's the commandments. I know they've become the 10 suggestions these days, but they still are the 10 commandments. And even back when they were first written in stone by the finger of God, the Israelites were down breaking them, even as Moses was getting the 10 commandments, making the golden calf, and having, well, a lot of other stuff that went along with the revelry. But here's as we look at the second commandment and keeping God's name sacred, there's the curb or you know, civil law, and it even is encoded in our civil law. There's rules of perjury is lying under oath. You can do jail time for that.
Because you swore to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help me, God. You're invoking God's name and swearing to be honest. It's perjury. It's punishable under U.S. law. There's used to be more stringent laws by the Federal Communications Commission about using God's name and other profanities on the airwaves and television. Most of these laws are being relaxed. Not a good thing. Scared to watch our kids watch anything on television these days because of all the profanities and everything else. So we even see it encoded in civil law, but there's more importantly God's law, and that where God holds this mirror up and we see ourselves as breaking this commandment. And you know, as Lutherans, it's a little more stringent. It's in thought, word, and deed, by what we've done and what we've left undone. When you get done with that explanation of what we should do, well, we all come out guilty. And that's purposeful. There's the hammer also of God's law that hammers us, brings us to the foot of the cross. But there's that, we might not be prone to vulgarities or swearing, but maybe not being honest in everything. There's using God's name and not being truthful, whether it's in a court setting or elsewhere. And lest any of us think, well, you know, I'm not really guilty of that. There's also that the flip side, as I often tell the kids, I said, flip it around. There's what's the opposite of not misusing God's name? It's using God's name in prayer and praise and worship. Have we ever missed a worship service or an opportunity for personal devotions being in the Word? Yeah, that even makes me squirm, and I'm a pastor. And so there's that mirror of God's law that it shows us our sin, and we just, it leads us to Christ, and to repentance. But there's also that God's law as guide in sanctification, living out our lives as disciples. How should I live, God? Well, here's 10 simple commandments that will make your life a whole lot easier the more you follow them. So there's the benefit. There's benefits built into each of these when we seek to live them out.
Being honest under oath, for marriage vows to
and sickness and death. Honor and love till death do us part. We tell the judge, I'll tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. We tell the truth. Taking the opportunities like we did today to worship God, to hear His word, meditate on it. You know, as we contemplate God's law, it leads us to Jesus, leads us to repentance, and makes us cherish those words all the more that we're forgiven and loved. God knows we're sinners. He knows we've broken His Ten Commandments in thought, word, and deed by what we've done and left undone. And so those words, I forgive you, I love you, mean all the more. There's tremendous power. There's tremendous power in God's name. Our sins are washed away. We're born again in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the mystery of holy baptism, God places His name on us. We're born again, born from above as His child. Wow. There's a lot in that name. And we've had that family name placed on us, as I was telling the children, that name Christian. People are watching us all the time, and we try our best to point them not to ourselves, but to our Savior. That's something we as Lutherans do a good job of. Don't follow me, follow Jesus, because I'm following him, and I'm living in repentance and faith as I follow him. I haven't arrived. I'm asking him to change me, transform me. And that's what we do as disciples, is we ask God to change us, transform us by the power of his name. That name placed on us in the waters of holy baptism, that name that we bear, we pray, may hallowed be your name, O Lord, that name that I bear. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, life everlasting. Amen. We rise for prayer. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And for the gift of divine peace and of pardon with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And for the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And for this nation, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And for those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And for all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphaned, and for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, especially, O Lord, we lift up to you the families of Ashley Dunbar and Joyce Stagnan, as they mourn the loss of loved ones. Grant them your peace and your presence, O Lord. And for those in need of healing, we lift up to you Roland Carlin and Walt Grump, Robert and Mike Laughlin, Bill Galbraith, and Casey Koss, Floss's granddaughter's nephew Jackson, Lorna Wright, Delaine Jensen's niece Megan, and for others who need of your healing touch. You are the great physician of soul and body, and we place these, your children, into your hands. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we pray the evening prayer from the small catechism. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day. And I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For in your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve us. Amen.
Peace, sir. God, in your name.
Thanks be to God.